Off like this. Okay. You know what it was for. Yeah.
You don't know what's in here.
See that? Yeah, that's that.
That's when you're smart.
That's slick.
Yeah, you gotta have a coffee cup.
Yeah. There's nothing more dangerous than a mug of whiskey, though.
Oh boy. Nice. It gets progressively worse.
Yeah.
You go for.
Yeah, so we're recording, right? I wanted to ask you two. All right, the first time I ever experienced someone extend or play with the word beautiful was this rapper Keith Murray. And he had this song called The Most
Beautifulest. Yeah.
The most beautifulest thing on this earth is just like that.
Oh, nice.
And so it's like, do you remember that vibe?
Of course.
It's like,
I don't know that. I gotta
find it. It's a classic.
Yeah, you know, right, we can share screen.
It's right? a hip hop classic.
You know. I'm gonna give you.
Actually, you could, someone else can share screen. I just turned you off a little. Soon. One of them.
Where'd you go?
Here we go. Here we go.
So I'm gonna make it so anybody can know.
Keith Murray, the most beautifulest thing.
Yeah, and you know, and the thing is, he never told us what it was. It was just like, it's just like that.
It gets in you.
It gets in you. Yeah. Yeah. Thanks. Yeah. Hold up. Murphy. All right. Yeah.
Like fullest.
Fullest. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. You know?
Fullest.
Let's
see. Yeah.
I like that. Like, it's suggestive. You can, like, think about it. It's like kind of can, like, transform and, like, flow through. Like, you know, mean different things.
Yeah, yeah. It's
really suggestive too, you know?
It's weird.
I think with, you know, yeah, there you go.
Keith Murray is this mic.
I haven't seen this in years.
Super Bowl cap analyst. And the moderation, incubation of my creation is instantaneously with my vocabulation accumulation. Strictly Death Squad LOD.
He's taking a creep.
What was that?
The hook is coming up.
Skills and vocabulary too. From a history of this edition, it's all brand new. You're through. I'm interplanetary and like Doctor Who. So who? Wanna get chipped on, word is bone. I'm getting rhymes to the AM vote just wrong. Now Quincy, but I'm back on the block and not selling crack. I'm coming in with the fat, funk flows and tracks. So what you saying, black? With all that yakety yak. My order facts can't be beat with bats. I'm saying, I eat everything up on the menu and bend you and send you swaying to be continued. The most beautifulest thing in this world is just like that.
That's pretty much it, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. So like,
that's great.
You know, when Michael Avery.
Yeah,
he did one of their videos.
I saw that.
When I first saw and even before that, when I heard about the duo and the album release, I saw that you guys are the second ones to help extend the word beautiful, because beautiful seems like this ultimate thing. You know, like it can go no more, no more, less, or it's nothing in the middle. It's just like, boom, it's beautiful.
I love that.
But like, you guys reminded me of being younger and hearing this Keith Murray thing, of this guy, just his whole style was creating, extending, and retracting from a concept and a word. So beautiful-ish, it's like,
yes.
So I congratulate you guys for being the second person people in my life, you know, to deal with that word beautiful, you know what I'm saying? Because, I mean, you should be able to add on, expand on beautiful, you know?
Yeah, and to kind of like, to expand and maybe like undercut and, you know, encourage that it's, maybe it is, and sometimes it's not. And that's also cool, like to be good with not being beautiful also, I think is part of the ish, maybe.
Yeah, dope.
Or like that it can like you can have kind of like an idea of what it is or should be, and like even if it misses that mark, like it still is good and interesting and has like its own purpose.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Aspiration.
Yeah.
Like, I was just like make. I mean, I don't think we didn't talk as much about the title as or about our band name as we are right now. but like, yeah, I don't know.
That's not true though. We spent like so long like trying to figure out what we would call ourselves, and that's actually something we wanted to ask you all: is have you ever thought about having a band name for your duo? And would you? And could you? No.
I mean, I would.
Yeah, I would too. I guess we never got to a point to think.
We haven't. I think it's just too early in our collective experiences to like want to put a name to it.
Yeah.
But I wouldn't be opposed to it.
No, not me either. You know, and the way, you know, the way me and Krista collaborate, it's even the space that we're at now. It's in the space where we first met and we were just vibing on
just
that.
Just talking about
you
it.
You know, and just thinking about like, you know, we met in a gathering of creatives, you know, and we always had this playful vibe together. And think about, and you know, even earlier we were talking about staying in that idea of play.
Yeah.
And the person who reminded me that was Michael Avery, who did the video, like just like, we should always stay in this concept of playfulness.
Well,
but the piece so like, don't play, right? Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, that's Michael's whole vibe. You know, he's like, he's like every advanced creative that we admire, it's that plus the Muppet Show. You know what I'm saying? That's Michael. You know, that's like my, you know, my brother.
That's hilarious.
But so I guess what's so great about him when we connect. We're still in this play thing.
Yeah.
So we still haven't thought about.
We have a container. There's no container for it yet.
But it can't, but it's possible. And know, we'll come up with a fresh name or
that's dope.
Something playful, you know?
So, I love it.
Yeah.
I love like hearing you talk about how playful this project is. Cause like also like the experience of it, like has an intensity to it. Do you know what I mean? Like Krista, your delivery, it's like it has kind of an intensity and a directness. You know what I mean? And like it's, I love the idea that like play is a part of that. Like, how do you, you know, do you think of that as being like an aspect of like play? Can play also be kind of like serious and intense?
Yeah. I mean, yeah, I think it should be. I think, let's say like intensity versus, right? Cause I think intensity can come off as serious, but it doesn't have to be. Do you know what I mean? Like, I don't necessarily, when people say that, and I am intense by nature, like that's just a part of my personality, you know? And when I'm writing or making something that's in words specifically, it can be, especially when I'm reciting, it have a kind of a resonance of an intense sensation, you know? But I think there's always the feeling of like play or laughter underneath it, you know? And primarily I think because a lot of my stuff is chance operations, like a lot of the writing that I write is like very Bowie-esque, you know what I mean? Very like Brian Gazin, very William Burroughs, you know, I'm like playing on that chance operation. So I'm not necessarily sure what's gonna come out in the writing, but the delivery though, right? Like I could say, it just depends on how I'm saying it.
You know, well, if you think about play in kids, I mean, it is absolutely serious.
And very serious.
Yes.
Listen, because if you get off what they want to do, they will fight you.
Yeah. Just,
they're directed.
For real.
That's true.
It's their job. It's their work, you know?
It is.
Yeah.
It is. Yeah. Do you guys feel that intensity when you're making? Is intensity a part of the dynamic of your collaborative efforts?
I think so. And I mean, we in the sense that we're I feel like there's this like seeking this sort of intensity of like kind of looking for the thing that is, because our project has like, it spent a long time like kind of percolating in Sam's practice space, because we had these like 9 a.m. Friday morning rehearsals, which were like good for people and parents. And so we were like, cool. This, and so we just met, and we didn't have a lot of agenda at first, or like we didn't have a performance. We were just sort of getting together, which was really nice and kind of a new, hadn't had that kind of leisurely of a space to work in for a while when we first started. But then we were like, we could just do this forever. Like we could just like get together on Fridays and play something and have fun. But do we want to like make, you know? And so like, I felt like there was an intensity with trying to like, sort of like get us to kind of like make an album, play a show, like trying to get it out, manifest it kind of. Right. And I don't know, but, and there's, and then in the sound itself, in the like, look, trying to feel and like kind of get these really like textured kind of detailed sounds to kind of like read and like have be available to other people as well as us. Like it kind of, I don't know. I think there's some intensity in like the listening and that kind of thing. I don't know. What do you think, Sam?
Yeah, I think like an interesting almost metaphor is like how, like the first piece on our album, it's like kind of like this intensely focused just noise, like where we're kind of, you know, exploring these like dark registers of our instruments. I have like a hacky sack, you know, that I'm like rubbing on a piece of wood, which like that's playful right there, but it's like also it's the sound that's just like, you know, and then like Katie's making that same sound, but like the way that we orient ourselves to know like what the kind of like general tempo or like kind of that we're thinking of, like it's Prince's Little Red Corvette. So it's like we're thinking like Little Red Corvette.
And we're just like,
but like it's just the sound that's coming out as like
wow,
focused and like kind of has an intensity about it. But it's funny, like I don't think of myself honestly as like an intense person, but I mean, I don't know, maybe Katie, yeah. No.
Yeah, she had to get to a coffee book for that one. No, but it's great, you know, because we were talking about your sound, mm-hmm. you know, you two, and the word noise came up.
Yep.
You know, and it is something that we all embrace.
Yeah.
The word noise, and it's great to hear you bring it up because we were talking about it earlier, and it's like when is the starting point and ending point of the acceptance of noise, or like this this projection of noise, and the, you know, like what does noise mean, you know?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Because like what's very I don't even know the opposite of noise, but whatever is like
harmonious, maybe.
Yeah, you know, to one person that may be noise to the next person, and you know, so on and so on, you mm-hmm. know what I'm saying? So like mm-hmm. because I'm like, you know, your sound or these, when you guys venture into that realm, I'm kind of, you know, I want to say I'm used to it, but it's something that the door's open always, you know what mm-hmm. I'm saying? And that comes from, you know, years of listening or searching, you know what I'm saying? So it's great to hear you use that word noise, because that's when we were hanging and just discussing the sound and things. And it was just this description of a sound, like noise is a thing, you know, it's mm-hmm. a beautiful thing. Mm-hmm. Not as noise is like, it's this thing that I want to push away from me.
Right, cacophony.
Yeah, it's great to hear. But I just want to, I don't know, get a better understanding, not a better understanding of like, what do you guys think where is this start or stop of the acceptance and projection of noise, you know, is there a true type of noise?
Yeah.
Or is it like fake noise? Like, that ain't no real noise. You know how people are.
Yeah.
I see what they're trying to, that's not real noise. You know what I'm saying? Like,
people and also, do that all the time. Noise your objective? Like, is your objective to make noise? You know what I mean? Like, what's the objective? I'm intrigued by all of it.
Yeah, yeah, so.
Well, and likewise, I mean, there's like, in terms of like, if we think about noise and intensity, right? Like just even in terms of like a sound spectrum, right? You have like, you know, noise, technically, I think if I remember, it's like that it means that it has frequencies that it has activity at all parts of the spectrum. So it's like, you know, if you think about like white noise, for example, right?
Yeah.
So there's like this idea of like, of a spectrum and like a sort of broadness of like, of density, right? And sort of like, like you're kind of filling up space in this sort of vertical way almost. Like, I was wondering about like for your piece, like thinking about like, maybe we can sort of like get it, sort of think about noise, like by talking about also how y'all think about like music. Maybe we can add noise into the mix, like music, text, sound, noise. Like, how do these different elements, how do you think about utilizing them? Or do you think about them as distinct when you're working?
Yeah, yeah.
I don't.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't see them as distinct necessarily.
Yeah. Yeah, no, go ahead. Go ahead.
Yeah. So, like, when do you, like, how... Maybe you could just tell us more about that piece, which is so incredible. And like, it's part of this beautiful project that I wish I had gotten to see and hear and in person. But yeah, maybe you could just sort of tell us like how the project came to be and like how it's.
Well, yeah. you want to, cause
I'll start a little bit and then you fill in.
Cool.
We were brought in, really it was Fo Wilson handpicked us. You know, I don't know if she even knew that we knew each other necessarily.
Oh, she paired you up.
She paired us. She was like, I want Krista Franklin and Ben LaMar Gay to do this thing together at my exhibition. And, you know, we were like, cool. You know what I mean? Cause I mean, it's just more opportunity to expand into what we were already kind of starting, I feel like in different situations. So it gave us a container, you know, to play in. And so we were very much responding to her exhibition to some degree, right? That was like, that's the idea, that we're responding to the artwork, we're responding to the sculptures, we're responding to the space, you know? But I think we also had our own individual as well as collective ideas about what we were trying to push through in the moment.
As a repetition, Black imagination is not corporal. It's a projection of sound that induces a cleansing in us, in the emotion felt at our least stable. Only at the moment when, as human beings, we learn the precise measurements of plant, animal, infantness, a feminine and masculine temperaments, and to not speak scarcity, can Black freedom bloom.
Thank you.
did you write your text ahead of time?
I did.
Did you compose your music ahead of time or your?
No, it was all improvised.
Okay.
But I think, you know, to continue with the story from Krista's point of view, I met Fo in Lagos, Nigeria, you know. And so Fo, and we were talking about this early, like in Chicago, it's been these amazing creative women that have like, whenever I'm down, they've always tell me like, yo, keep going, what you have this, you know, that's where I'm from, you know? Mm-hmm. So I met Fo through another friend, great, you know, teacher in the movement field, Onye Ozuzu.
Yeah. Was,
you know, and, you know, I met Onye in our community, you know, Constellation and Lynx. So,
yeah.
And so Onye invited a few friends to Lagos to be a part of this amazing dance, this basically block party, because Lagos has these amazing dance crews, the movement crews, these young crews, is super amazing, you know? And so basically they picked the Colonial Street, the old British Colonial Street, which is abandoned after they left the Capitol, after the Capitol move, you know? And we were in this point, it was like, I mean, we were literally improvising in this building where there's open safes with old, like, top secret government files. You know, yeah, you know, and that's how crazy, that's how they left this Capitol.
Right.
You know,
just abandoned it.
This is, it's like, fuck it, we gone.
Right.
And we're doing this improvised piece and moving piece, and we're reading this moment when Nigeria is asking Germany for funds to help build a bridge.
Yeah.
And they just left it. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So like, and that vibe, that's where I met Fo.
Mm.
You know, it's all these creatives, you know, and these intellectuals together on this Colonial Street trying to give it this life for young movement artists, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And so with Fo's vibe, I remember carrying bamboo for her for miles for her to set up her installation. And it became this like very meditative thing where I'm having like, you know, two big sticks of bamboo on my shoulder and my arms. And I knew I was doing it for Fo and Norman T, these great designers in Chicago, Black House crew.
Yeah.
And so that's where I met Fo. And I met Krista here in this place here.
Right.
And we met just like, and a joyful, festive thing,
yeah.
You know, communicating. So the combination of like, you know, Fo probably didn't know that me and Krista had this like joyful beginnings,
yeah.
You know,
mm-hmm.
And then with me and Fo's beginnings in Lagos,
so intense,
you know, yeah, all this intensity, mm-hmm. You know, and for her to trust us, and me knowing Krista's language in the festive mood.
Mm-hmm.
And with me, you know, if we're at a party, I'm listening to all of Krista's jokes.
Same.
And I'm literally following her jokes.
I'm literally following him.
Yeah, yeah. I'm supporting her jokes with any like, textures.
What's he saying?
So it was the same thing. It was the same thing when Fo, another friend that we have, a mutual master,
mm-hmm.
You know, I don't say master, I hate that word, but just an intense human, beautiful human being, you know?
Beautifulest person.
Yeah, exactly. You know?
Fullest.
It's so what we did at Hyde Park Art Center was just remembering Krista's language and how she delivers her intensity. It may be quiet or it may be loud.
Mm-hmm.
And having that, and of course, like I bought up all my gear because I didn't know what textures to use, mm-hmm. You know, because you know some gigs you bring too much gear, you're like man, it's just messed up the flow of music. But the way Krista delivers, I had to bring everything just in case.
Yeah, you know? I like that though.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I need to have, you know, and also I was just thinking about when we're talking about noise. You know, one of my earliest influences is Public Enemy.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, and you know that was like a part of their sound, like they embraced noise, like that was a part of the aesthetic of Public Enemy. Mm-hmm. And even like the way that Chuck D's voice was used, he's like one of my earliest vocal influences, like the way that he uses his voice as an instrument of like projection and like power, like that's what I'm seeking to do a lot of times, especially when I play with musicians. Because listen, you know, you all know, sound and music is so much more seductive than voice. It just is, to me, unless somebody is singing, you know, like then it seems like a more harmonious like balance. But when somebody's talking sometimes or like reading or reciting, like I think that I'm always listening, this musical aspects, the sound aspects are, I'm more lured, I'm pulled more to that, to listening.
That's so interesting, because I feel the opposite. I mean, I felt the opposite, like I feel like the voice, whether it's sung or spoken, is like so what I focus on, which I think is why I often don't, where I don't use text a lot myself, is because like I'm still like trying to figure out how to balance those things, because like for myself as a listener, it's like I feel like I get kind of like this tunnel vision and or tunnel hearing, and I can't. Yeah, it's that's interesting.
Yeah, I always think of the sound and music is more powerful than the voice.
I find when someone's talking, I listen more for content, like for what the words are, what they mean. And if they're singing, then I like, if it's like a second of a melody that catches my ear,
yep.
Then I pay attention to that. Otherwise, it's like almost always like bass line, drums. Like when I sing a song, it's always the bass line, and people are like, what song are you singing? I'm like,
yeah. You know the song, then you go right to the bass, bottom of it, like,
yeah. Yeah, so I'm really bad about that, but like very clearly, like spoken text, like that draws me in. But like, I don't know, I actually think like for your project, like, I don't know, Ben, I don't know, Chris, I was like reading some of your like interviews and stuff, and like seeing, you know, your interest, and like you talk kind of about trying to like, you know, bring elements of like ritual into it. Yeah. Like Ben, like feeling like you were kind of like meeting Krista in that space, and like together those kind of like fusing into some like some new thing that like never existed before, like the sound of like your like music kind of like, you know, meeting your voice in certain kind of like registers and like kind of projecting something new, you know what I mean? So like I don't know, it was kind of amazing. I didn't find myself ever like checking out and being like, what did Krista say, or like what was Ben even doing there, you know? It was like,
that's encouraging, Sam, thank you
thing. Yeah. It felt like, I mean, it's honestly shocking to know that you hadn't like made music before that thing.
Yeah, I agree, and I think it's the same thing with your textures together. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? It's the same vibe, and I think we all create music without our instruments. You know, the music happens way before we touch our instruments. Ooh. With the person. You know, I've seen. Like right now we're in these, you know, rectangles, but like I remember you two on the earth. You know what I'm saying? Like I remember being with you guys with every, you know, and you know, even if in passing or a quick joke or at the bar at Mike's place, you know.
Yeah.
The music is being made there. You know, Chris, we met at the Black Artist Retreat.
Yeah.
You know, just talking and laughing, like mm-hmm. The duos formed then.
Yeah.
You know, so like, I really believe in that. Just the music starting way before we touch the things we choose to project the sound through, you know? And like with you two, I don't want to say, I didn't want to say like, before I heard it, I had a feeling of how you two would make a sound together. Mm. You know,
that's interesting.
I remember that last gig. You know, I was supposed to join you on that gig, and I just couldn't. You know, like,
yeah,
because we've been, our feet have been on the earth together at one point. a few times, you know, maybe a couple times, maybe a bunch, you know? So you already have that, already know that vibration, you know, even though that the vibration I think I know is gonna expand in so many ways, expand, retract, and, you know, disappear, reappear. Yeah. But it's like, man, I felt, you know, we've been together, standing on the earth together, you know what I'm saying? And the type of sounds that we explore, all of us, you know, we explore the earth and beyond, you know, some of the most natural things.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? So,
how did you two begin to do your collaborations together? How did you form that? Could you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. We were kind of like you're saying, we knew each other from around, and I really liked Sam's music that he was making, and I had been kind of trying to find the right percussionist to work with for like a while, because I had been feeling like the stuff I wanted to play on the bassoon like was so intensely percussive that I wanted just to like kind of like join with someone who's that was their vocabulary, so I wasn't like tricked into playing a fucking melody if I didn't want to, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
and so I think I might have initiated, but I don't know. But in any case, like I was kind of like in the zone where I was thinking about I was oriented towards like playing with percussionists, and Sam obviously is a drummer and a percussionist, and yeah, so that was part of it. And then also like we had a really compatible schedule. Like it worked out, like we could keep it going, you know, so it was sustainable for a while in a really important way.
Like, I don't know if you've ever experienced this, but like in different collaborations, you know, like sometimes they're hard to maintain because like one person, maybe they want to like email all the time, and then you're like, I can't respond to that many emails. Or they never respond and it feels like not reciprocal. Like there are like weirdly practical things that have kept this collaboration going, which is like, I can send an email and then Katie will respond at about like maybe one, like maybe next day, maybe in a week, maybe 2 weeks.
Yeah.
And I'll do that same thing. I can respond to one, maybe 1 week, maybe 2 weeks. And like, I don't know, like just some, like that kind of like flow of like really boring stuff kept this going. Like we both have kids, like we could meet at this time. Now Katie lives in Atlanta, so that kind of
fucked everything up.
It puts a damper on things.
Here we are.
It's a damper.
Now, months later, still talking, still like doing things because of that steady, boring flow of emails.
Yeah.
Yeah, you'll dig this. So you two used to meet 9 a.m. Fridays, right? So in Chicago, there's always a lot of morning rituals, because the music scene. You know, if you want to think about like Light Henry Huff, Avril Rod, and all those old lake rituals that were happening. You know?
Oh, I don't know about the lake rituals.
I just found out. Like I knew about the one ritual, you know, like Bongo Beach on 63rd for years.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like starting from like Phil Coran having those sessions there.
Right.
Okay.
And like, you know, you're going to 63rd Beach, it's like a community of percussionists playing all the time, you know? But then I found out, you know, from our friend Mike and other like D. Alexander, there was these morning rituals. You know, we were by one, like the Great Lakes, you know, it's like, it's a very special, it's a very special body that's near us in Chicago that kind of influences the vibe, even if we don't realize it, you know? Mm-hmm. So there are, like, Chicago has a tradition of like early morning rituals. I mean, I meet in the park, I play in the park every morning. Sometimes I go solo, but I know these runners, these old ladies that run every day at 7 a.m. Mm-hmm. And we developed this thing. First it was like, hey, you know, first it was like, oh, sounds good, hey. Then like, you know, a year later, what's your name? You know, like, you know, to like, you know, 3 years later, I'm gonna come to the show, but never. But our whole relationship is in the morning at a certain period in the park. You know? So did you two feel that you were a part of just vibrating in the morning with someone else is strong. You know what I'm saying? Did you guys feel that you were a part of this tradition, this early morning?
Interesting.
You know, sound tradition.
I wish I had felt like that.
Yeah.
We should have had this conversation years ago, Ben.
I was like, what?
I just learned it too, Sam. You know, I'm just like, damn, okay.
No,
we piece it together. It's like, we are, all our shit.
You're in the tradition of something.
Yeah.
All in the tradition of something, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, definitely. Like, but I do think there is something really special about what you do first thing in the morning. Like, for me anyway, or in the morning, like how you kind of get your, like how I spend my time in the first few hours, like it makes a big difference to how the rest of the day goes. I know that.
Absolutely.
That's why the cell phone, the first 20 minutes is like scrolling through Instagram. It's like, I don't want to do that. I don't want to.
I'm trying to train myself not to do that too.
It's hard. They got us. You know?
They hook us. They hook us real easy. And also the time piece is on the phone now, right? So it's like, that's when you're just really picking up to get the time, and then you get sucked in.
Yeah.
You know?
Mm-hmm. 100%.
Yeah. On time. I would like to talk about time in the notion of time in your collaborations. Will you guys, can you talk a little bit about that? Like, how do you think about, I mean, especially since we have this thing about the ritual of mourning, like, do you, when you think about the music that you're making, do you associate it in any way with time, duration, you know, even with the what you're using to make sound? Because I know that you're using instruments, but also many things that other people would not consider to be traditional instrumentation. You know, like, how do those things figure? Like, do you ever pick up like one of your kids' toys and be like, I'm gonna play this? Because it's right here, I'm playing some Legos. I'm gonna chop some Legos together because they're right here. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, you know?
Yeah, for sure. Do you want to go first, Sam? I feel like I've been talking a lot.
About time. Well, we got Prince already. That's some time in there.
Yeah.
I think, I don't know. It's interesting. Cause like, I don't know. In like the, I don't know, new music world, there's like lots of like pieces composed where you're supposed to like look at stopwatches and like do a thing for a certain amount of time. And like sometimes I find that like for me, some people that works great for. But for me, I always find that I'm like trying to like fill in like a pre-existing container. And then like I'm like, okay, when is this time gonna wrap up? And then like things end up having kind of like no momentum or duration or like orientation in time. Like even though there's a time, it feels like not purposeful. And yep. Like I kind of like lose what I'm doing. And it's maybe this is like a weird way of thinking about it, but it's like maybe like collaborative time is something. Like where working with another person like draws out kind of like a certain trajectory, like a certain relationship of like relating to each other, but also like duration too, you know what I mean? I don't know if this is relevant, but like there's this musician Alex Minchek in Chicago, and he was like doing like a solo improvisation, and he was talking about how he approaches it like a duet. Like he tries to come up with like these two layered things so that like they kind of like can like present their own trajectory within his own playing. And I don't know, I thought that was interesting, and it made me like think about like time where there's like a kind of a friction that can bring out like momentum, yeah. Like kind of emerge something new shapes that unfold. It's like, I don't know if I'm really, is this?
But, well, yeah.
It's fine. Yeah.
But also like, I think, well, I was gonna say, Sam, like in terms of collaborative time and getting back to this idea of like morning rituals, like I totally would not have had it together to like play for 2 hours on Friday mornings at 9 a.m. if I hadn't had Sam, who I was supposed to meet up with. Like that was like really helpful. Like for me, I do so much better if I have somebody that I'm like, that I'm doing the thing with. Like I'm like, I'm accountable to somebody else. I got to show up and make and do this thing. Like I have a hard time maintaining like routines. I make a lot of plans for routines, but then like they derail or they shift, or I don't know. I've never been somebody who could like always do yoga, you know, it just, right. I like it, but it doesn't work out. Or like practicing the bassoon when I was like younger, I was like not a good practicer. Like I could do it for a little while, but so anyway, I feel like in terms of like, there's like this structuring of time that is helpful when you have like somebody to kind of negotiate those commitments with. And then similarly, like in the music, I think like there's, you know, we were working with some parts of the music are composed ahead of time and decided upon to different degrees. Like there's one piece that's like really, really like specific rhythms written out that we have to play in unison. And then there's others that are just some shapes that we gonna kind of use to like make a sound in a certain duration and contour. And then some of them are like, okay, you're gonna do that like high thing. And then I'm gonna come in with this. And then we're gonna just like hope for the best, you know? And so I think like each of the pieces in that way for me has like a sort of different experience of like temp time, you know, like some of them are like counting and like groove or like a, you know, a meter or a, you know, a feel. And some of them are like about like kind of trying to set up a long thing that can like kind of breathe. So I think we thought about different experiences of time when we were trying to come up with like pieces that felt different. Like I think that was part of, you know.
Yep.
Yeah, I wonder if you experienced that too. Like really fast, I like one other thing about collaborative time. Like I just think about like bands trying to Like if you make a song, like why do you choose the, like how many times you should repeat something? But if you play, as soon as you play with one other person, you're like, I don't know, let's do this 4 times. Like it has to be like put out in the air. You have to say to another person, and then like a thing takes shape just because there's 2 people instead of like a single person, you know? And like it's interesting that you talk about like the pieces that you've performed as being I don't know if you consider like the Juneteenth concert and the Folayemi Wilson concert as being like kind of a similar piece or the same. I mean, like obviously there's some different text in the Juneteenth one, but like how do you think about kind of like, you know, like some moments feel composed and like things happen and switch at a moment, and like were those like pre-planned, or were those, was that kind of like collaborative time where you somehow connected and like a structure emerged, or what? Yeah.
I'm trying to see what he's gonna say about this.
Yeah, okay, you can try.
No, look, I was like, yeah.
No, you know what? Just what, you know, hearing everyone. You know, I think, you know, whenever I'm in that sonic world with Krista, you know, naturally, just from being like a, you know, a side of me being like a beat maker or adding some artificial effect on things. Mm-hmm. When I hear Krista, I always think of this long tail of, let's say like reverb, mm-hmm. from her intentions and her words. Mm-hmm. So I almost feel like I always put myself kind of behind like her words, like I live in that long tail of reverb. Yeah. So she could say one word and be on the next sentence, but I'm like cleaning it up. Like if this is, you know, this is the word, this is the tail, and I'm cleaning it up. But then within that long tail of her resonating, mm-hmm. whether in the space or in my mind, mm-hmm. you know how it is when a car passes you and sometimes the pitch shifts.
Yes.
So, you know, when Krista states something and I'm living in that tail after her, all the shifting and all that rhythm happens there. And that's why it's easy for me to improv, because I'm hearing this rhythm differently. Like, all right, let me just do this right here, because that's what the sound is telling me to do. That's what's like the tale of her words, mm-hmm. of her story, of her intention is telling me to do. So I, you know, always like, you know, let her say something. And then I'm just like, you know, I'm being washed in that waterfall of all that stuff. I'm like, all right, let me just pick that out. And mm-hmm. and yeah, that's the approach of improvising. It's just to like,
living that
tale of that. You know, I'm just using the example reverb from that, you know. Like,
I love that.
We don't plan very little. I mean, some, like even with the performance that we recorded, that was recorded, when we had, I think we had one rehearsal before that. And we were kind of like, what are we going to do? And you know, Ben was like, we going to do what we do. And I was like, right. So like, there's times that like, there, so, and you know, and then that rehearsal, when he started playing, I was like, oh, this is, forget about it. I was like, I got this. He got me. We're good. You know what I mean? It's like, I never worry with Ben. That's the other thing too, like about trust that I wanted to talk to you too about too, like trusting, right? Your collaborative partner. Like there's even been times, and I've told him, like, even with that performance in Foe's exhibition, I would forget I was fucking performing. I was like, I was literally like so enraptured with what he was doing sonically that I was like, oh, that's right. I'm actually performing with him. I need to jump back in here and say something, right? Because I was so caught up in what he was doing sonically that I thought I was in the audience. You know what I mean?
Well, and there's,
I had to play in that, inside of that space that he was creating. So I just wanted to hear what you were going to say about that. I was like, it's very much like, I'm floating on the high that he's bringing to me. And then I kind of bring my thing in, and my stuff is more structured because I feel more comfortable with a structure. Mm. You know what I mean? I feel like very, like, I don't know what, I can't improv writing like that. I'm not an MC. You know what I mean? I'm a poet. I'm a very much a paper poet too. So I need to have a script. And then I can play around inside of that script. I may or may not read certain parts on the script, depending upon what he's doing sonically.
Right.
This line might go well with what he's doing. It's not necessarily a part of this part in the poem order, but I'm gonna read this part because it feels like it's in conversation with what he's doing sonically, right?
Yeah, and I'm, you know, I see words as being vehicles for emotions, you know? We have these things, and me being a big fan of these vehicles, and I flirted with creating these vehicles with poems and lyrics, you know? And so, like, you know, when you with someone who, like, yeah, I can trust those vehicles that she's gonna put in front of me to add to. But then before that, we've already laughed and joked with each other. So all this music didn't happen already.
Yeah.
You know? So it's kind of, I think the smartest thing for me as a listener is to just, you know, when I'm improvising, it's not like I'm creating this thing. I'm just like listening to what has been done, what it wants me to do to push it forward, or, you know what I'm saying? So.
Ben, I love that too. Like, I'm wondering, now I want to know what you think about other things. Like, I mean, maybe this is a different conversation, but like, I love that Krista's like, when Krista performs, I'm like the reverb tail. But like, is there like, are you like, in different collaborations or different settings, are you like, I'm the delay, or I'm the like flange, or like, what, you know, like, are you?
That's interesting. Yeah.
No, it's, I'm thinking, yeah, I think so, you know, listening to, you know, Katie, we played together, you know, a few times, and I'm always listening to the people I'm in the space with. Mm-hmm. And so, and just with my natural personality, you know, I'm not like, I know when I pick up an instrument that, I'm still exploring, and I'm, you know, it could be totally confident or totally filled with insecurities, you know? Mm. And so to help me keep going, like if I'm in this bed, this deep pool of insecurities, man, I'm listening to all the stuff to help me, like as a life raft or lover's rock, just to hold on to, you know, a buoy, you know, in the big sea. So like, I think so, you know, like, if I can recall, like I remember Katie the last time we played together, you know, with Sam and, oh man.
Peter?
Yeah, you know? So that was a vibe. That was a vibe. You know, I went in there, you know, like knowing Katie personally and on the ground, and then knowing Sam and Peter just in the cyber world. Like I'd never been on the ground with them before. And so I had to like, with me, I had to anchor and trust that Katie's there with me.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You know? And I'm just putting that as an example of just being in this open sea and finding a buoy or some type of something to hold on to. And also like, guy, not just to hold on to like, all right, I need this, but just like, all right.
Or like to be like, we got each other, and
So I like Sam, I can't say like, you know, it's been a while. I can't, if you give me time, I can think exactly what effect I was for Katie. You know what I'm saying?
I love it.
You know, it is, but totally, I think with everyone that I play with, it's a certain thing that calls a certain, you know, which effect to live inside of, you know? So I think so. I think I do think about
play
it.
Your position. You play just a position.
Just to stay in, and sometimes with being used to playing all these positions and all these different scenes, you know, all these different ways of projecting sound, it gives me the confidence to like, all right, let me provide this thing for someone to, you know, we switch roles as listeners and projectors, I guess, you know. So
yeah.
It's not like I'm luckily I'm at the point where like I can create something, you know. I used to have this fear. I can represent the beast of it. I may not know the scale of the thing. I can't go into the whole, open it up and like, yeah, that's this bone, that's that bone, this bone interacts with the heart this way, blah, blah, blah. But I can say like, this is that beast and this is this beast's environment. Like I'm still at that, I'm happy at that level, you know, where like I started off as being someone just open up the body of the beast, like this is the spine, this is that, you know, this is that scale.
Like, what's the beast?
Yeah. Where does this, you know,
what's the outcome?
How does the beast walk? Mm-hmm. What is it, you know, what's the environment of the beast, you know, instead of knowing like how the heart connects with, you know, when in all art, you know, they teach us like, you know what I'm saying, like the inner scales of the beast, mm-hmm. and that, like, so now I'm happy that I can, you know, I don't want to say be the beast or deal with the environment, these other things, mm-hmm. you know, so.
I just want to add one little thought to this idea of the reverb with your collaborative sort of approach to sort of projecting and then like tailing each other, because there's also the idea of like the white space on the page of the text and like thinking about like
love it.
A poetic text as having like intentionally like visualized aspects, and mm-hmm. and there was this beautiful spaciousness to the piece, which also of course just the word space like makes us think of the sort of astronomical aspects of the project. So like it was really lovely and just like captivating in that way. But like you're saying, Krista, there's like gotta be this trust in order for not play when you're in a duo, especially, or to not be speaking, or to not, you know, to just sort of wait. That's like really, I feel like that's when you feel like, okay, these people trust each other. Cause like one person's just like letting the other one do their thing for a while. And it's not out of like a lack of some kind of lack. It's just because they really trust them to
fill it in, right? Yeah. To do the work, the same kind of quality as well as like intensity, I guess, of work that you're doing with whatever it is that you're doing, right?
Yeah.
Like you, and it is, and it's taught me a lot. I think like working with Ben and also just other musicians has taught me a lot about like breath, pacing, space. So I love that you brought the page into with that, like, cause the page is for me very much a score. You know what I mean? It is like this is where you take your breath. This is where you're supposed to be quiet. You know, like when you see those spaces, they're there specifically for a reason. You know, it's like I'm dictating to you how you're supposed to read this piece.
Right.
You know what I mean? Yeah. So yeah. I really appreciate that.
I have with the empty page, like Krista, you make paper as well.
I do.
So like, How do you decide on what type of paper to make or why?
It's usually just from like what's available.
Okay.
You know what I mean? I mean, I have some fibers that I'm very drawn to, but it takes a lot of preparation and planning to either get to that fiber or to beat that fiber down, you know? And that one is a very long, speaking of durations, abaca, which is a Filipino fiber, and it's a plant. And it takes like 6 hours to beat it down to like where it's real fine and translucent, semi-translucent. So like, you know, it takes a lot of pre-work to even get to the point where you're making the paper. So it's like, but that's funny that you would talk about that, because I definitely feel like when people encounter my handmade paper pieces, I don't think that they understand that the paper is handmade. And that it is a part of that is the art. Mm. So if there's nothing, it seems like it's nothing there, but it is something there. Do you know what I mean? Right. It's like, you know, even like quiet, right? Like when you take pauses in the work that you're making, that's on purpose. Mm. That vacuum of sound.
Yeah. Yeah.
Not a vacuum.
There's like this moment in I forget which side, the A or the B, but it's like, okay, I have it in my notes. Hold on. I want to find it, because like, Krista says something specific, and then there's like, Ben, the music just like drops all of it for a second.
Oh my God, I know exactly what part you're talking about, because yeah. I love that part. When he does that, it almost makes me want to stop altogether, because I'm just like, it's done.
It's right. Because, yeah, it's so good. But it's like, so at least what I remember was, Krista says, if you want to find deep space, and then Ben pulls it out, and then you say, it's like, the timing is so amazing. You're like, go inward. And it's
just like, yeah, yeah.
I love that, yeah, that part.
That was all luck.
Oh my God. It almost, and it, you know, it's harder to scream or like to show on the stage, like you're like so hyped up. So thank you for noticing that and mentioning it.
It was awesome. It was super cool. Because also like the music that Ben had set up was just kind of like going.
Yes. Mm. Peace.
And then you're like, it's not gonna, we would never stop, but it was so awesome and like unexpected to have it just like, and then it's like, boop, just back. It's cool. But it could go away now. Now we know it could go away anytime, which is like adds this whole other like kind of element of intensity to the performance, which I think was really great.
Oh, beautiful. You know, with you three, you know, I think, you know, with Krista paper making, and you two, you know, you not only like create, I don't want to say create the instrument, so, but like, all right, Hacky Sack Against the Wood.
Yeah.
Katie, everything you do with the bassoon. I remember doing it or seeing you play, and you had your setup, your bassoon hooked up. And it was like a stereo thing. And it took like 40 minutes for the right channel to come in, or for like a particular, or maybe like a octave drop. Mm. You know, like, man, expand on that. Cause that's something I would love to get more into of creating, I don't wanna say creating instruments, but you know what I'm saying? Like experimenting with these different things to make sound, or taking a traditional idea and expanding it,
yeah,
into this.
Well, you don't think you do that, Ben? I feel like
for a little bit, but I think you guys are like on a whole other.
What are you talking about?
I mean, or even just taking like your percussion approach. Like in the modular world,
I love the percussion.
In the synthesis world.
Just love it. I mean, all the different instrumentation of the percussive is just like, it's so exciting to me.
You know, or just saying, when Katie's saying like, man, I needed to find I've been playing this rhythmic and percussive way, and I need to find this, you know, this other person.
With a that partner. Same. With that sensibility, right?
Go Sam.
Oh, I was just gonna say, like, actually, like a lot of like what I'm doing now is like it came from like trying to meet Katie like where she was already. Like, I played drums, I played percussion like a lot for a long time, but like I'd never played with Katie before. And then like I sit down, like the first time we met, I think I had like it was like a tape deck on like a floor tom and like, you know, whatever. It was like a drum set, but like then we played and it didn't like, it wasn't in my mind like working. I was like, Katie's got this sound that's kind of like a blend of like acoustic, like electronic, like this weird hybrid world. And like these like just kind of like raw sounds, they're not like, they're not like in the same place as Katie. Like I have to make it to that same place. And so it took me like a very long time.
And I was like, I'm not moving.
I mean, if you had said that would be fine. Like, I don't mind trying to go where you were. Like that was so cool.
Funny.
Like, yeah. So like, I mean, obviously then we created something like new together, you know, I mean, maybe your setup didn't change, but like, it didn't matter. Like we made like a new thing together. So I don't think it was like you just being like, intransigent, like throwing, putting your foot down, like I'm not gonna.
I'm not doing anything.
No work on my part. No, but it was like I don't know. A lot of it, like it kind of felt like born out of the necessity to like try to meet another person where they were. You know what I mean? And like,
I think, yeah, and like try because like in some ways our we could make very similar sounds, but the means of like how we made them were very different. And so like they kind of, it's a little bit like that uncanny valley thing where it's like, it seems like the same, but it wasn't the same enough. And so I think like we were interested in kind of creating a kind of mysterious sound world where you didn't know if it was Sam or me or how, you know, when, what, who was doing what. And so that, and that, that, and so that required like, yeah, Sam to do quite a lot of work and us to find the right materials to that would work for us. And me to like be super careful with the whammy pedal, you know, stuff like that.
Yeah. It's true. We were talking about that earlier, being super careful with the technology that we all have, you know?
Yeah.
Even if it's a pencil, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Being thoughtful.
Yeah.
And percussion is a problem because like every when you play well no I love
in what world
but like it's a problem in that like in general like one sound can kind of, like one thing can do make one sound, so you know like you hit a thing it makes just that sound. And so like I don't know, I played in this other duo in the past where I like had this enormous landscaping stone that caught, it weighed like at least 30 pounds. And I would carry around two of them. But like, and they were awesome. Like I love them. And they made this kind of like magical sound, especially like in a resonant space. Like you rub it with a rock and it's just like kind of, it was like this weird like A minor chord. But like, it was amazing. It was worth carrying around that rock, honestly. Yeah. Like it could only, that's all it could do. Like I couldn't do other things with it. And then so, with percussion, I started like imposing this rule on myself, like that I have to, like anything I do, it has to be able to do at least two things. It has to make at least two sounds. Kind of how it like this instrument, do you know what I mean? Like this thing that I felt like I could perform. I had to like kind of constantly like focus and refine over time. So like in a way, like I don't think I'm like, it is like this weird instrument that I've made. You know, but it's not like it was only kind of like by accident, like by me not wanting to bring, because my impulse is to bring every single item of like awesome. I have a bunch of like 7-foot pieces of E-bar, you know, that sound great when you like scrape them. It's like, wow. But like, what do you do with like, I don't know. It's like easy for me to just like get out of control. And so like, I mean, Ben, like, I mean, to me, like, it seems like you're absolutely like instrument building, and like I mean maybe it doesn't feel like that, but it seems like this thing that you like, I don't know, your performance setup, it seems like this thing that you've kind of like are able to kind of control, and like also like weirdly like let you like control you for a second and then like pull it back in. I mean I don't know how do you think about like what things you want to put together.
I think it's the same what you said, trying to like meet Katie where she is. I think I approach it the same exact way with whoever I'm improvising with, you know. It's just knowing how beautiful and magical this thing that we're all in love with, you know, with sound, and we all have these different approaches, and yes. It's so amazing that it puts me in the space like a back, you know, backs me up. And I think the same way, just like, all right, I'm just gonna try to meet these people in a certain space, you know? And it's a mixture of confidence and insecurities, you know? And it's just, it's just a open space of listening and seeing what can be provided. Cause I am like, sometimes I bring too much gear. You know, like, oh man, I can bring this drum machine here. I got it. Oh, that's right, I have a cornet. Like, cornet is like the last thing. It's like, oh, I played a cornet too. Great, I could have that. You know, I mean, I just had a performance where I just bought too much gear, you know. But it's just,
being I don't understand open what y'all saying when y'all say too much gear. I just don't. I'm like, it's appropriate. All of it. Bring it.
Yeah.
Muchness. Let's have it.
It's just that push and pull with the person, my personality.
I like that moment where you've brought all this stuff, but then the choice to not use it is also like, I think pretty, it feels good in a way. You're like, oh, I carried all that and my back hurts, but I'm also like, I got all these options and I don't have to use them. And that's
it.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes. Right. The option.
Yeah.
It's like Anthony Braxton when he has like the giant bass saxophone, right? And he's schlepped it from like, he's like, it's taken, you know, but he'll just walk up to it like for one moment, like, and then that's it. But it was like, you never know if you might need to do that with that bass saxophone. So you better have it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just have too much anxiety. Like, I mean, like I've playing percussion in college. Like I still have, like I've been out of like undergrad music performance, like percussion school for like 22 years, but I still have anxiety dreams about showing up to rehearsal and I'm still like putting together all the percussion things that I need. Like it's easy for me to like get overwhelmed. You know what I mean? So like, I love Krista that you're like bring the muchness. I think that's what you're saying. Like, that's my impulse, but also I feel like all of a sudden, like the weight of everything, like,
You're curating on site though, right? You, like, you brought all the materials, but you're curating on site. You're like you said, right, Katie? It's like, what am I going to use now? What's appropriate in this moment?
Yeah. And like, I think, you know, you want to have, like, you don't, the last thing you want is to like have like a thing you want to express or say or do and like not have the,
it's the word,
not be able to. And I mean, that was totally how I got to using pedals with the bassoon, was like, you know, there's sometimes where the music like wants a really high sound and I couldn't do it with just the bassoon. I couldn't get up there, but got that whammy pedal and then you can like get up there, you know? So like, I feel like in order to meet the needs of the moment, like you're saying, Ben, like in order to be ready to meet people where they are and to like, you know, be what people need and what the music needs in that moment, like you gotta have all that stuff maybe, or you gotta have like enough stuff that you feel like you can access what you need to access.
Yeah.
Well, Krista, like in thinking about like stuff to bring to performances, do you think about like gear or do you think about like text as like stuff? Like, I got to have enough of these pieces of paper. Yeah. Like, this is going to be like a certain, like, do you think about that as kind of like a gear or whatever?
Absolutely. I love that you asked me that question. Absolutely. I mean, I definitely bring always more than I should in terms of like writing, but with me and Ben stuff, not necessarily, because I knew it was like this piece and I might bring like one other additional piece to like get in the mix. I mean, I think I feel like I got more loose with the Juneteenth performance. That felt definitely more like, I'm just going to improv this. And I trust Ben to just like do what he does. You know what I mean? So there was like, I mean, like 4 or 5, maybe 6 different pieces inside of that performance. And I just kind of like would randomly read parts. They weren't even like whole pieces most of the time. But see, because I love music and I love musicians so much, I'm always thinking about gear, you know, and I get really obsessed. Like when my friends have, I'm like, what are you bringing? What is that? And I'm like, what is this thing? What does this do? Like, I literally like always want to know the gear. And then because I used to perform with Allison Chesley, who goes by Helen Money, she and I used to perform a lot together and she got me hooked on the Line 6. So then when she started running my voice to the Line 6, I was like, I need to purchase a Line 6 and literally carry it around with me everywhere. Because I like when my voice, I can make it echo. I like, you know, that's when I really became obsessed with the technology piece.
Yeah.
And what I could do with it as a writer.
That's, you know, really cool.
But I don't own any gear. I mean, I think the only thing that I brought to our performance was my little Tibetan singing bowl. So like the little ding, ding, dings, like that's me. The ding, ding, dings in the voice. That's, you
ding,
know.
Ding, ding.
Yeah. Ding, ding. Like whenever you hear that little chime, that's me doing my thing.
But you processed your voice some, right?
I did. In the second part, but that was pre-show. That was like post-production.
Oh, okay.
So when we performed it, my voice was not run through anything. I mean, except for when
we were just talking about that.
Ben would, like, you know, capture my voice and then echo it. Like, those were the only times that my voice wasn't running through anything. But on the recording, there was the section that my voice is very robotic. I was attempting to do something live with that. I feel like I should have left it. I don't feel like I should have added that part in.
Oh, it's really?
Yes.
But I don't want to tell you, yeah, like how you should or shouldn't do it. But as a listener, like, it was really striking.
I'm ambivalent about it. But that's because I'm used to hearing my voice run through machines. And so I'm just kind of like, I think I went over the top with that because I like it. I could have just like left it more just me. Because I was trying to mimic how an Android sounds. You know, like,
oh,
I was
like
the flattening of the voice that happens. I was trying to do that naturally, but I didn't feel like it was coming across enough on the recording. And then I wanted to ramp it up, but I felt like I went too far, you know? But I'm glad you all feel differently. That's comforting.
Not too far from my ear.
Okay, that's good to hear.
I like it.
Thank you.
You know, I want to ask you because, you know, I enjoyed the ESS performance, you know? Like, how was that experience as a duo? Whatever. I mean, we all been through, like, the virtual
performances.
But the type of duo and the type of sound that you two make, like how was putting that sound into that format?
It was really different. I mean, we basically just, when we played live and when we made the record, there were like pieces that we were supposed to play, and they had certain materials that like sounded like this, and we knew it, you know, and we practiced them, right? More like a band. And then for these streaming concerts, it was all improvised. Mm-hmm. I think for one of them we had like a list of words that, like, words like, I don't even
bubble
remember
wrap.
Bubble wrap, moss, I don't know, just like stuff. And we were like, okay, we'll just go through this list and like that'll help us stay oriented. But Sam said that he didn't really pay attention to the list. So
yeah, I'm not a rule follower. I'm not a total rule follower. But yeah,
I think because of the delay, because we were not in time, you know, in the same place. So because of the lag with the technology, we were just like, we're not gonna try to play like super synchronized, rhythmically precise stuff. And we're just gonna like kind of let things happen.
Smart.
Yeah, it was, I think we both did different stuff. Like I used this, like a drum and some like seeds and stuff that I hadn't done it live with him. And Sam was, you can say, but you had some new setup stuff going on too. So.
Yeah, I've been like kind of constantly revising my setup like throughout this whole pandemic, just cause like there's something like mindlessly therapeutic about being like, okay, maybe this piece of metal would sound better on this piece of wood than like the, you know, like I don't, it's like creative without being creative, you know? And like, that's, I don't know, a lot of that has helped me get through this pandemic where like I'm making progress, but like, but I don't know. I thought like the sounds we did together were cool. And I liked it, and I felt like it helped us kind of like build up like some of that trust as performers, you know, like where you're not sitting there. And so like, there's not like all of this stimulus. It kind of more is just like living in that like very focused, like in literally in your head world, you know what I mean? Where you're listening to that other person. It's not like, there's not the sense of like time passing in front of others where you're like, is this getting boring to those people? It's like, it doesn't matter. Right. Like, I'm just here with Katie, like literally in my own bedroom. I have a weird piece of wood hooked into my computer and I'm scraping it with like a piece of metal.
I love that. Yeah. I love that.
And like, I don't know. I think it helped us build like the trust, but like, there's a little bit like Ben, where you were talking about how like the music is already made like before, you know, the thing starts. Like it's hard to feel that in a performance setting online where like seconds before I washed like a cup, you know, in my sink, and then I walked like 400 feet to my bedroom and then it's like, okay, now I'm scraping a piece of wood with
in front of the world.
Yeah, like or not, like is anyone there? Who knows? Like that kind of like that kind of like where what for me a lot of what makes like a performance feel real is like it's like I gotta be outside of my head. It's like with others. It's like there's like a like performance moment where like this is happening. You know what I mean? Like a reality that kind of like descends on the evening that comes through like other people being there with you. And that for me was like nearly impossible and super bizarre in the digital world. I don't know how you thought. Like on that Juneteenth concert, you were performing together, right?
We were in the same space.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, we were in the Arts Bank. Mm-hmm. And I think before we did that, I said, so obviously June, mm-hmm. my first, I don't know when your first virtual show was, but my first one was maybe because I was in the middle of an art residency, and you know, I had to move everything virtually. We were talking about it, difficulty. So I had I moved from like this like, you know, dream access to all this stuff that they had to being in my little small coach house, almost like studio apartment. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so my first performances maybe like in late March, April, like right when it was going down. And I had to go into this like this image I had from Hollywood, from an old Times Square peep show that I would see in movies. Like, you know, somebody would put a quarter in a machine, and it would lift.
Yeah.
You'd be like, all right, I'm gonna have to do something for 35 seconds and then Until they put another quarter in, you know?
Wow.
And I remember feeling that. And the only thing that got me through that was thinking of those performers in the old peep shows, these old quarter peep shows. Like thinking of them as like, of how we would think about, like Katie, you just shared a story with Braxton, you know? So I had to think of these stories I hear of these creatives that we know and that we inspire by, like Braxton, for example. Mm-hmm. I had to put the peep show performer up with the stories I hear about Braxton and George and all these, you know, Pauline. And so, you know, all these creative humans that we get inspired by. I'm like, all right, I'm in this Manhattan, like late 70s peep show, quarter machine. Yeah. And That's a level I felt emptiness of reacting. That's one I wanted to ask you two about, especially with the sound that you two project together. And I wanted to see how it felt for you to be in that little peep show box.
Wow.
But that's what helped me out. I had to put the peep show performer, you know, and I'm saying it in the most respect because that's what got me through it. You know, it's like, all right, here I am. Someone put a quarter in the machine. The curtain's about to lift up, and I'm gonna have to go.
Yeah.
Without any
feedback.
You know, any feedback? Because when I would see it, and this is all like, you know, I'm a Midwestern boy. I'm looking. This is all the Hollywood perception. of how it used to be in Times Square, you know? It's like, all right, it goes down. Okay, here we go. It's over. No, you know, I'm not expecting anything from anyone. you know, I don't know how they saw me on the other side, but it's just, that's the vibe. I'm in this this virtual peep show, and that's what it is. And that's what helped me get through it.
Did it feel good when you could kind of come up with that like mental idea of what you were doing, or did it still feel?
And after I finished it, my first performance from my residency, I literally had to walk around my block a few times, go get a pack of beer. when I perform anyway, there's always this level of sensitivity anyway.
Yeah.
Because you're dealing with your whole history around it, the future, the present, you know, how you sound bad today, like a certain part of your body is not vibrating with your instrument at that particular moment. Mm. And so all this like sensitivity comes in. And I had to walk around my neighborhood for an hour. It's like, all right, this is what it is. And then I came up with like remembering the peep show performers who are like valid performers, you know? And I had to put it up to like, all right, cool. You know, the way Zora Neale Hurston inspires me, the way she inspires me, like I had to dig. I couldn't dig on her to get me out of this hole. I had to go to the peep show performers, whoever these beautiful people are. Mm-hmm. Just like, all right, here we go. So it was an after fact of dealing with it to help me get out of that weird virtual hole, you know?
I guess maybe a little bit similarly, I was thinking, I really didn't like the getting the tech set up for those streaming shows was just like, I wanted to shoot my face off. Like, I just like hated it so much.
Yeah.
But then I always was like, and it never felt as good as actually playing. I mean, like, the only reason I still play the bassoon is because I can improvise with people, like have those moments of free improvisation with people where I'm just like, there's no other feeling. I'm like a little bit getting goosebumps thinking about it. It's like that feeling of when you're in that moment and you're like, you don't know, like this has never happened before. And it's just like emerging right then. Cause like somehow miraculously everybody's like gotten on the same page. And then like it goes away and that's fine. But like, there's like, I'm always just like guts. I'm so euphoric after those sorts of, you know, performance moments with improvisation. And I mean, I did not feel that euphoria, you know? But I did feel like I felt like I had done something that was meaningful and I had shared something with Sam. And like, it was still, like, you know, a little bit like what you're saying, where it's like, well, today this is the work. Like, it's not gonna give me this like euphoric feeling, but today the work is to show up to this screen and like do this thing. And it's not like the most fun time I've ever had, but that's the work. And like, I think maybe that's how I relate to what you're saying, Ben. It's like, yeah, I mean, we talk about these like, are like idols or whatever, you know, the people who we aspire or and look up to. But it's also, yeah, it's just like sometimes it's like you just gotta do the work, you know, and it's
yeah. And like Sam, you said after you finish washing that cup, well, 400 feet and like, what is this? Well, I'm here with Katie.
Yeah.
We made a lot of music together before, like we know the music. You know? It is just like, and Katie's same thing, like, all right, this is it today. It's with Sam. Boom.
Wow.
No, it's and it helps us reach for other you know, like I had to go to the peep show performers. Yeah. And it made me realize like, yo, it's the same creative vibe. Like
right.
You know, and this is the community that's gonna help me understand this thing.
Wow.
You know, so it's
it's funny because I think that I've had the most deep conversations with musicians around the pandemic and how it's affected musicians. And like, I feel like for me as a poet, I mean, most of my engagement throughout the panorama online was like just like reading. You know what I mean? Like I wasn't really performing music per se, except for when I was with Ben. So it's like, to me, it's like I'm in my house just reading something. And I didn't care necessarily if somebody was there. You understand what I'm saying? Like I wasn't really looking for like the feedback loop, what I call a feedback loop, that actually musicians really thrive on, that feedback loop. You know what I mean? I always forget that that's like a definite part. Cause I remember, you know, even Allison was like, how are you doing right now? Like she was flipping out. You know what I mean? Like I want to get back to the stage. And I was like, I don't, it's not any different. I'm just going to read these poems and look at people for a little bit and then be like, bye, and click off and then go back to drinking or smoking or whatever as I was doing. You know what I mean? Like it wasn't, you know what I mean? Like, I don't necessarily feel like I need it, although I do miss microphones. I will say that I have a deep love affair with microphones and I miss them. When I get on stage again, I'm gonna scream into the microphone. People are gonna be like, Krista, it's deafening. Because that's how much I miss microphones.
I'm but, excited to go gear shopping with you sometime, Krista.
Let's go. Let's go. I'm coming to Atlanta. I'm gonna come here.
That's so interesting. It's like listening to you, like Krista, I feel like I hear a performer. I mean, maybe that's because you're a performer when you're with Ben. Like, so do you think of then like reading poetry not as a performance?
I do and I don't. I feel like there's two separate components to it. You know, the writing piece is very insular and quiet to me and very solo, which is why I'm not bothered by reading stuff, because I read things aloud to myself in my apartment, right? So it's not necessarily the audience. Like sometimes I'm my own audience. So I'm reading things to see how they sound. I'm really reading them to get acquainted with the words and the flow of the words, right? But I feel like there is definitely a performer in me. I mean, from the time I was a child, I've been on stages. So, you know, my mother forced that hand, you know? So she wanted me to be comfortable on stages, in public standings, you know? So I've been on stages since I was like 7. So it's definitely a part of my work and my practice to be a performer, but like I'm not an actor or anything like that. And I would be highly uncomfortable, you know, like even cameras like flip me out. And I do get a lot of anxiety before all shows, including these virtual things. Yeah. I have a lot of anxiety. And then sometimes I cry. Like I go through the whole breakdown sometimes where I like sob
afterward.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'll click off and I'll be in shambles the rest of the night, Katie. Like literally like crying on my couch, like, girl, what happened to me? What did I do? That was terrible. And also the fact that these things are recorded, to me, it's like forever. So if you fuck up, mess up, excuse my language, it's like, right? It's there forever.
Yeah, I know. You're doing, like, totally, like, we're doing this thing that we've never really done before, which is, like, make our work through this thing, and, like, and yeah, and it's there forever. Yeah, no kidding. It's terrifying. It's terrifying.
It's very scary, but it's also beautiful because it's a part of the archive now. Do you understand what I'm saying? Like we are literally making the historical documentation, right? That records a whole era, right? And so that's something I think is attractive about it, even in the mistakes that we may see ourselves that other people don't even see. I think it's important that is recorded for posterity's sake, for the historical record.
Well, also for the idea of like, this is like a process too. Like we're all just like, you know, it's not about that perfect object. It's like this sort of thing where we're just like, this is our life's work and we're just like, got it, you know, put
it's
it out there.
So. It's the evolution. It's a process. I love that you articulated it like that. Absolutely.
And I think, it's important. And even this conversation, you know, no matter where it ends up.
Yeah.
And
however it lands.
You know, your album and the connection with this community, even if it like, you know, this, with this connection being for now, just me and Krista, you know, that's, people need to, the future needs, and that's going to be beautiful. That's the things I've dreamt of. We were just talking about, it's like, oh man, what, like Sam, Katie, Kristen, Ben, like,
yes, had this beautiful conversation, this gorgeous dialogue.
You know, that's a big, beautiful thing.
It's incredible.
That I love about it.
And then that means we have to make an album or do a show.
Let's go!
I'll extend the Airbnb here in Hot Springs and you all head over.
Let's go.
Yeah.
I would love
it. You said Hot Springs, Arizona, you're in?
Arkansas.
Arkansas, okay. Man, yeah. I've never been to Arkansas.
Love it.
Yeah, I've been a couple of times, like, because Molly's dad lives here, so I've been here.
Well, man, you know, like, you guys have a beautiful sound together, you know, and...
Congratulations on this album. You know, congratulations on all you're doing together.
Yeah, likewise, congratulations to you. Piece is stunning, and I'm so excited that that maybe this conversation like shares these projects with some different people. That's really great.
Yeah. It's
and evolves into something that we co-create.
Yes, yeah. Please.
Are you gonna make some more stuff?
I'm trying to get him. Look, I proposed something, but the lights didn't go off in his eyes, so I don't know if he's interested.
No, it did go.
No pressure.
Like, I guess, you know, we'll see what happens. There will be other things.
Krista, you forgot to get down on one knee or what? Like,
listen, you know this one. He's beg. No, like, I gotta be like, please, can you just think about it for a minute? He was like, yeah, okay, I get. I mean, but yeah, we'll play.
The answer is yes.
Yeah, the answer is yes. Whatever it's gonna be.